Hello everyone, and welcome to this inaugural Sustainable Finance and Shipping Forum. Good morning or good afternoon, depending on where you are joining us from. We have a very exciting event for you here today, I think hopefully you will agree. We are fully locked and loaded and ready to go. Let's get this show on the road and ship sailing, pardon the metaphor. Thank you so much again for taking the time to join us this morning. We have, I think, a very exciting two-hour session planned here. As you can see, the agenda is on the screen. We have divided the day into three parts. The first part is more of an overall aspect to sustainable finance and shipping. We'll be joined by Andrew Stevens and Marco Kisic. Then we have, in the second part of the day, a more detailed focus on specifically green bonds in the shipping sector. And there again, we're joined by some very interesting speakers as well. And finally, we have the third part of the day is on sustainability linked bonds, something clearly of very topical and recent interest. And there again, we're here for some experts within this field and some proven veterans. And then finally, we'll wrap up the day with what we call a fireside chat. So no slides, just a good discussion with industry leaders, and yeah, hopefully that should help us conclude the day from a broader perspective as well. But without further ado, I'll invite Andrew Stevens from the Sustainable Shipping Initiative to join us.
Thank you, Jakob.
Good morning. Good morning, Andrew. I will leave the floor to you, and please take it away.
Great, thank you very much. So good morning, good afternoon. I'm very pleased to be here with you all today. My name is Andrew Stevens. I'm the Executive Director of the Sustainable Shipping Initiative, or otherwise known as the SSI. The SSI is a multi-stakeholder collective of ambitious and like-minded actors spanning the shipping value chain, driving change through cross-sectoral collaboration to contribute to and thrive in a more sustainable maritime industry. Our members are ship owners, charters and operators, shipyards, marine product equipment and service providers, banks, ship finance and insurance providers, classification societies and sustainability nonprofits, who all see the potential and want to work towards sustainability in shipping. Yesterday, we were very pleased to announce our newest member, Singapore-based Wilhelmsen Ship Management. In the next few minutes, I want to help set the scene for today's event. First, I'll talk about what we at SSI view as the key issues in sustainable shipping right now, and broadly what we mean when we say sustainable shipping. And then I'll move on to why finance is so important to shipping's sustainability agenda, and the role that you as lenders and investors can have in pushing that agenda forwards. The SSI works across different areas to create a more sustainable shipping industry, and we currently have working groups focused on decarbonisation, for example, defining the sustainability criteria for zero and low carbon marine fuels, seafarers' rights, and safe and responsible ship recycling. As a collaborative and member-led organisation, we make an effort to engage with industry stakeholders, as we are doing today, and learn about the challenges, goals, and trends in sustainability for the maritime industry. I'm sure it will surprise none of you to hear that the key industry focus at the moment, as we see it, is decarbonisation and the transition to zero or low carbon fuels and related technologies. The fuel transition shipping is undergoing right now is a massive undertaking that would be impossible for one single group of stakeholders to achieve alone. Thus, it is great to see the momentum building within and beyond the shipping community. Initiatives like the Getting to Zero Coalition, where SSI is a knowledge partner in the Fuels and Technologies Workstream, have brought together stakeholders from the maritime, finance, and energy sectors to tackle this decarbonisation challenge. And it's estimated that at least $1 trillion is required to decarbonise shipping by 2050. Primarily on land-based infrastructure, such as production, storage, and distribution facilities for low and zero emission fuels, for alternative and new fuels such as green hydrogen and ammonia, amongst others, which will enable this fuel transition. investment on energy efficient ships and other emissions reduction technologies, as well as other forms of sustainable finance, are also being implemented, increasingly incorporating emission reduction goals and targets into financial instruments for shipping, for example, through the sustainability-linked loan announced by Maersk in February last year, which is being used to further enable their zero carbon emissions ambitions. Just last week, as you all know, and I'm sure will be discussed later, Norwegian ship owner Odfjell issued the first sustainability-linked bond in the international shipping industry, linked to their decarbonisation and fleet transition plans, paving the way for others in the industry to utilise these tools in their own sustainability and decarbonisation journeys. However, although decarbonisation is a key concern at the moment and is the area that the industry has rallied around, sustainable shipping is much broader than this. As we work to do our part for the global sustainability agenda, we need to consider what sustainability means for shipping. UNCTAD notes that economic, social, and environmental sustainability criteria must be integrated and mainstreamed into marine transport planning processes, policies, and investment decisions. We need to think about and improve on the other areas, such as ocean health, social issues like seafarers, labour and human rights, governance issues, and transparency, amongst many others. This is a collective journey, requiring not only ship owners, operators, and charterers to act, but alongside all other actors in the shipping value chain, including retailers, investors, and lenders, who must come together, contribute to, and enable the industry's collective journey to sustainability. Finance plays a key role and has significant leverage to incentivize and enable the industry to become more sustainable. Whether through sustainable finance tools like green and sustainability linked bonds or sustainability linked loans, supporting R&D and the development of operational and technological improvements through investments, or through using their leverage to demand transparency, accountability, and disclosure when it comes to issues such as emissions, responsible ship recycling, and labour and human rights. I'll touch on a few examples of this, starting with an ongoing SSI-hosted project, the Ship Recycling Transparency Initiative, or SRTI, which brings together demand-side stakeholders, ship owners, shippers, or cargo owners, and financial stakeholders, around the transparent disclosure of ship owners' recycling policies and practices. Through the SRTI, lenders, investors, and marine insurance providers can demand transparency and disclosure on ship recycling, incorporating non-emission metrics into their decision-making, enabling them to use their leverage to reward good practice and raise industry standards. On the decarbonisation and climate side, we see financial institutions coming together through initiatives like the Poseidon Principles, assessing the climate alignment of their shipping portfolios, providing clear guidelines, and encouraging transparency and disclosure, once again enabling informed decision-making in support of environmental goals. As Tristan will no doubt discuss in his presentation later on, the Climate Bonds Initiative recently launched its shipping criteria, following a broad consultation process engaging ship owners, operators, and others to develop robust technical guidance, ensuring the ship owners are aligned with the Paris Agreement. There are many ways for ship finance actors to come together, not only with your customers, but also with one another, as you're doing today, to develop a common understanding and help each other drive that sustainable transformation. As you can see from the examples, the key here is informed decision making. Transparency, disclosure, and building relationships across the value chain enable you as lenders and investors to use your influence to improve conditions, whether it's lowering emissions or demanding better working conditions. It's difficult to overstate that the power that finance has to demand sustainable performance, to demand transparency, to demand innovation and efficiency improvements, and consequently propel the industry forward. In closing, I want to emphasize that making the shipping industry more sustainable is a collective challenge, requiring engagement and collaboration from many actors across this value chain. As lenders and investors, you all have a role to play by demanding sustainability and very much supporting the clients on the how and on the mechanisms needed to trigger those improvements. Partnering with the industry is essential. I hope this provides you with some valuable context around shipping sustainability challenges, as well as the power and responsibility that you hold to accelerate raising the bar on sustainability performance. I very much wish you well in your conversations throughout today's event, and look forward to hearing more on the ways in which in which the finance sector can influence, shape, and accelerate a more sustainable shipping industry. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time.
Thank you so much for that, Andrew. I think very relevant for setting the scene and giving us some context. Before letting you go, maybe I can just to dive into one question or two. You touched upon a number of different aspects that the Sustainable Shipping Initiative are working with. Would you mind just commenting on your roadmap specifically and also what the finance component of that roadmap entails?
Yes, so we have a roadmap, which is not our roadmap, but it's a roadmap for the industry and contains six vision areas, of which one of them is finance. And we see that the main goal there is to develop financial solutions that reward sustainable performance and engage and enable large-scale uptake of innovation, technology, design, and operational efficiencies. And it's this that is the guiding goal for the industry, to be able to support and incentivize high sustainability performance through preferential access to capital or other financial instruments, and assign monetary value to the environmental resources to promote their responsible use, to contribute to reducing negative impacts. So not only not doing harm, but doing good. We intend to report on our roadmap throughout the period and the decades ahead. And we'll be reporting on this in the middle of this year. And we encourage all stakeholders to visit our website and contribute to shaping the progress along this journey of sustainability for the shipping industry by contributing to our blog on our website.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for that, Andrew. And I can only echo and support what you're saying and highlight that there's really a lot of different actors that needs to come together, not just within the shipping sector, across many sectors. And I think that's really what is exciting about these developments as well, is that the sustainable finance avenue allows many more participants to engage and really make sure that we can, as you also say, not focus just on the downsides and the risks, but also make sure that there's positive impact. I know that's something that that Katie will also touch upon later. So Andrew, thank you so much for spending time with us and best of luck.
Lovely. Thank you. Look forward to it.
Marco, could I kindly ask you to join us via video, please? Wonderful.
Absolutely.
So Marco, head of ESG research at Nordea, I will leave the floor to you.
Great. Thanks a lot, Jacob. And thank you to everyone. It's a pleasure being here. My name is Marco Kisic, and I head up the ESG research here at Nordea. We are part of the equity research division, and we basically publish research on sustainability in close collaboration with our equity analysts. Over the next roughly 10 minutes, I'll be talking about some of the high-level trends that we see in shipping ESG, with a particular focus on climate, and also some of the areas of discussion that we typically have with clients in this area. So shipping is an incredibly efficient means of transport when it comes to climate impact. In fact, it is one of the kind of means of transport that has the lowest impact from a CO2 per ton kilometer. So that's one of the reasons why it's close to the heart of a lot of policymakers which are focusing on climate. As an example, the EU, as part of the Green Deal, has specifically refer to shipping and the willing to shift part of the road freight transport onto ships and away from the roads. Having said that, at the same time, it is also a sector that has a meaningful climate impact. In fact, it's responsible for roughly 1/10 of transport total emissions, which is equivalent to 2% of global emissions. And it's often labeled and categorized among those hard-to-abate sectors, meaning that it's a sector where the decarbonization route is not an obvious one, and it still has to, the trajectory to decarbonization still has to be defined. So a combination of different approaches will be required for the decarbonization of the sector, going from more behavioral slow steaming to business model and business practices, all the way to technological shifts and changes. And this is all the more relevant given the steep decarbonization trajectory that is required if we are to achieve the Paris Agreement goals, as that chart on the right-hand side shows. That's just one of the various many scenarios available, the sustainable development scenario from IEA. If we turn to the next slide, the chart on the left-hand side shows a comparison of the Scope 1 and Scope 2 emission intensity, so the emission divided by revenue, across a number of sectors, the sectors that we cover here in Nordea. So this is a Nordic sample. And you can see how shipping is all the way to the right with the highest emission intensity. And this, in a way, is the flip side of what I mentioned earlier in terms of the efficiency of CO2 per ton kilometer. So shipping is basically the sector among all the ones that we cover here that has, let's say, the lowest value attached to the ton of CO2, which is an additional challenge for the sector when we're thinking, for example, about the policy making, and the inclusion of shipping in a carbon trading scheme, or it's a challenge also for portfolio managers when they have to compare shipping to other sector, and often they do use carbon intensity as part of their carbon footprint of their portfolios. Having said that, on the chart on the right-hand side, we can see how shipping companies are on a decarbonization trajectory. This chart depicts the carbon intensity of a sample of Nordic shipping companies over time, again, emission divided by revenues. And you can see that, beyond the volatility, we can see a clear trend downward. Turning to the next slide, regulation is clearly kind of the main driver of the decarbonization, together with the various initiatives that have built up around that regulation. There are numerous pieces of regulation going on and initiatives. Here we just report four important ones that we find interesting. Obviously, the IMO 2050 requiring, or like, with a name to half carbon emissions absolute level by 2050 compared to 2008. Also, targets on the carbon intensity 70% by 2050 compared to 2008. But one of the problems is that the alignment of these targets with the Paris Agreement are not obvious. So there's probably going to be a need to increase the level of ambitions. There is a revision of the strategy that is planned for adoption in 2023. So we're going to see in the next, 1 or 2 years, if there will be an increase in ambition and how that's going to look like. We talked about the Poseidon principles. Here, it's the signatories with the banking and the finance industries, which are, rallying to support this decarbonization, and basically for companies that are intending to greening their shipping finance and aligning their portfolio performance with the IMO 2050 targets. Here, the focus is more on efficiency ratios than on absolute emissions. Recently, the EU Green Deal has talked about the potential expansion of shipping in the ETS. It's something that is, drawing quite a bit of attention in the sector. And although the scope of this is still uncertain, and also if this is a decision that is going to go ahead or not, probably around Q2 this year we will have more detail about this. But we still need to see, even if it is included, in what form or shape it will be included. Will it be for only EU routes, or will it also be for global routes? Will it follow the ETS price, or will it have its own different price, and so on? So still a lot of uncertainty, but certainly there is a momentum and a direction to try and include shipping, at least the EU shipping, within kind of the broader Green Deal framework. And then lastly, but not least, the EU taxonomy. The EU taxonomy is probably the single most important piece of sustainable regulation in financial markets at the moment in Europe. And in the last version that was published in November, there is an inclusion of shipping in the taxonomy, which, you know, in our view is good news because it allows shipping companies also potentially to attract some of the flows that are going to be probably attached to the taxonomy. In the next slide, here we show what are some of the, you know, the criteria which are included in the taxonomy. In the taxonomy, shipping is included in two places, both for manufacturers of shipping and for ship owners and shipping companies. And the kind of the principle, the idea is that either we have a zero tailpipe CO2 emission vessel, or until 2025 is a hybrid vessel or is a highly efficient vessel. Although vessels which are dedicated to transport of fossil fuel, those are not included. So there's, you know, criteria that we will need to see if these criteria are confirmed and if they are, you know, they remain as they are. The next version and probably final version of the taxonomy is expected probably around February. So we're going to need to see what these criteria are, but certainly is a welcome change in my view, because as I said, kind of it allows some shipping companies potentially to have some taxonomy aligned revenue and to start attracting the attention of investors and financing more in general. In the next slide, clearly an elephant in the room is the technology. We're talking about decarbonization, the taxonomy, the IMO, kind of they all kind of give us trajectories which are quite steep, but how do we achieve that? As we said at the moment, there is not one single route to that decarbonization. On the two charts on the left-hand side, we report two scenarios from UMass, and the top one indicates a business as usual scenario, and the bottom one is the decarbonization by 2050. And I think independently from what specific technology this scenarios have, I think what's interesting is that until 2030, roughly the two scenarios don't differ so much from each other. And it's really from 2030 where the big bifurcation starts going on. There's a lot of different, you know, potential technologies available. On the right hand side, all the lines toward the bottom of that chart indicate what could be the fuel combination that could drive us to a decarbonization in 2050. There's a lot of different options, and we're going to need to, you know, wait a little bit longer to see which one is going to succeed, and probably a combination of this could be a possible scenario. So in the next slide, that is kind of one of the challenges shipping and ship owners at the moment are having. Basically a dilemma, a strategic dilemma. Do I kind of, you know, decide to be best in class as we speak? But that may run the risk that best in class in a few years down the road is not going to be aligned anymore with the decarbonization trajectory that's required. Or do I wait and see to, you know, understand better what's going to be the winning technology and kind of invest at that point? Because obviously the lifespan of you know, the capex that is required is quite extended. That, you know, could create a pent-up demand over the next few years. And we do think that the next 3 to 4 years are going to be very, very important from a technology perspective, but also from a business decision perspective in defining when does the investment cycle in this green technology will kick off and what's going to be that winning technology. So a space that is going to be very, very interesting to see and to watch in the next 3 to 4 years. So I stop there, I wish you a very good day, and I'm looking forward to follow the next sessions.